All right, in this section, we're going to be taking a little bit of a break from the, sort of the march of specific events, and we're going to be dealing with more sort of socioeconomic, a little bit of technology here in this discussion. Our major topic is going to be the market revolution that takes place here in the United States in kind of the first and second quarter century, kind of the first half of the 1800s, and as it accelerates as time goes on. So we're going to be talking about that, all the different factors that take place into this. We'll be dealing with labor, how, you know, what people are doing to work to make this happen, specific kind of inventions that are going to take place and change this, changes in transportation and connectivity between different economic situations here in the United States. Americans, really from the beginning, from the early 1600s, have been moving westward. They start along the eastern coast of the United States, along the Atlantic, and they almost immediately start going westward, all right? And this had continued. We'd seen one of the major sort of beefs that the Americans had with the British Empire was that they didn't want them to move any further west across the Appalachians. And of course, you had a number of Americans going, forget that, we're going. And so by 1840, one of the things that the United States Census Bureau takes place of is the population center, which is if all Americans were the same weight and you were to scatter us out where we live, and if you had to hang a string, where would the center of the population be? Meaning if we're all on the East Coast, it would all, you'd have to hang it on the East Coast so that way it would balance. But for the first time in 1840, the population center of the United States had actually moved west of the Appalachian Mountains. So this is a nation that is moving west, all right? Now you've got the pioneers, and they're going to be farming their way westward. In some cases, they're going to change local ecologies forever. Kentucky, for example, today is known as the Bluegrass State, which is it's a specific type of grass that it grows in Kentucky. It's really good for horses. It does have a slight bluish tinge to it, and so if you've been to Kentucky or if you're from there, you can attest to that, and you figure, well, that's the reason for that is because that's what, they found there in bluegrass. That's the native? No. these guys are going to do so much farming and so much terraforming in the area that the forests that had largely covered most of Kentucky are going to be replaced with large sort of open prairie land in much of the state. In some cases, they're going to ruin them in the south, where they'll come in, they'll set up these big plantations, first for tobacco and eventually then for cotton, both of which are very deleterious to soil chemistry. And basically what they would do is they would just sort of farm it until they couldn't get any more out of the soil, and they would just pick up and they would leave. It was easier to transport the plantation than it was at that point to sort of replace the soil chemistry in some of these places. And so you'd have then very sort of depleted soil that, of course, poorer people would move onto and kind of do the best they could with ground that had been kind of farmed out. Now, at the sort of bleeding edge of all of this is the people that are very, very far out into the wilderness, sort of by themselves, that are kind of the leading edge of this civilization, the mountain men. All right, and these are some sort of sometimes lonely, oftentimes pretty weird dudes that are kind of off out there by themselves, sort of eking out a survival, doing pretty well in some cases financially, but still, they're living in cabins and they're doing this kind of odd stuff off. Out in the wilderness, they don't necessarily have to live in mountains in order for them to be mountain men, or at least of that same kind of culture. And some of them had reached by this point, by the mid 1800s, the Rockies. But they're going to roam all of the West for their prizes. They're fur trappers. They're going to be selling these animal pelts for massive profits because they had become wall adornments and hats and clothes and in some cases rugs for wealthy Eastern Americans and also Europeans. So they're getting actually pretty good dollar for their trades that are going on. And this again causes such ecological impact that they nearly wipe out the beaver. And then later when we get into the late 1800s, we'll see that they nearly wipe out the buffalo. So these are some of these guys. This is what you would see if you're in the western part of the United States. These wagon trains heading ever westward. I know it's hard to think of sort of Tennessee as like the western United States, but at one point it is, as if people are heading just across the Mississippi River into places like Missouri and Kansas. But these long trains, these white top covered wagons, as they head sort of ever westward, you'd hire some trail boss, some guy that knew the way, and then you would just head off westward and you have ford rivers and do all that kind of stuff. If you ever want to get a sense of this, just play the old video game from the 1980s, Oregon Trail. It gives you a good idea of this. These are these mountain men. Typically, they're living kind of solitary lifestyles. They would come together in what they refer to as the rendezvous, where they would trade with traders for the supplies that they needed, gunpowder, bullets, medicine, food, clothing. But for the most part, they're making a lot of this stuff for themselves. They're living off by themselves. They're trapping the animals, and then they're going to return those back for resale. All right. One of the major changes that had been going on throughout the 16 and 1700s that really is picking up steam here in the 1800s is the way that the United States is creating a viable, self-sustaining, continent-filling society, and that is conquest by cradle. Through the hips of American women are going to pass enormous numbers of future generations of people. At some point, I've seen some of the estimates of this, that the fertility rate for like American women, something like the average was like 10 here in the early 1800s. Okay, and so it shouldn't surprise us too that one of the leading causes of death for women was childbirth, because childbirth's kind of dangerous, kind of scary. You know, if you've ever taken a Lamaze class, if you're a guy especially, it's really, really scary. But it's also, you know, kind of dangerous medically, and you do that enough times, and there's a decent chance that it's going to kill you, okay? But when you look at it, you say, well, why is this? Okay, well, part of it is that there's nothing on TV, so these people have to do something with their time in the evenings. But there's actually a sort of social underpinning for a lot of this, in that a lot of these American farms, especially the ones that don't have access to slavery, and even some of the ones that are in the South, but if you're not rich enough to buy slaves, you need workers. You need somebody to work the farm. You get sort of these large tracts of land that have to be cleared and planted, and, well, children, they make great little indentured servants until they get old enough to sort of talk back and leave the farm. And so one of the questions then, of course, is, well, when they do get old enough to sort of marry Becky Sue or, you know, whatever his name is, and, you know, Billy Joe, and then they're going to leave, where are they going to go? Well, you need more farmland available. So that's was part of what is churning this frontier sentimentality. But American women throughout this period, not only are they doing all this sort of difficult, sort of tough pioneering kind of work that you have to do in order to sustain yourself pretty far out from civilization. So it's not like you just say, oh, we're out of food, well, we'll just pop over to the grocery store and get some more. No. Oh, the Indians are attacking. Let's call the police, right? No. Women and these men have to do all this kind of stuff, but the women are also going to help double the U.S. population every 25 years. So this is a huge kind of deal. And this is some of these guys that you would see out on the western frontier. This is a Kansas family. When photography finally does begin to come in, this is a little bit later than the time period I'm talking about. It's the late 1800s. One of the things you see a lot of is pictures of children. And the reason for that is not just, you know, oh, it's a family photo. It's to show off. Hey, look at how many kids I cranked out. So that's what you see a lot in the photographic record. And here's a couple of pioneer farm women as they're sort of going out, a mother and a daughter. And I like this one because the mom looks tired. So, you know, you got all the stuff to do, and of course you got all the kids to look after. It's going to get you tuckered out by the end of the day. Also adding to U.S. population is going to be immigration. The first massive wave, there's going to be really two massive waves of immigration that's going to take place here in the United States in the 1800s. One kind of early pre-Civil War, and it's going to calm down a little bit, and then it's going to surge again in the late 1800s. So this pre-Civil War wave of immigration is going to be a major, major social, political, and economic factor in what's going on, what we're talking about. So farmland is going to expand, but generally speaking, that's going to be conquest by cradle kind of stuff. Americans, for the most part, are going to be producing enough people to sort of fill up that farm space. The urban spaces, though, of the United States are also going to be swelling, because generally speaking, these are going to be filled up especially with new immigrants coming into the United States from outside. Now, the two main contributing countries during this period are Ireland and Germany. Later in the 1800s, you'll see Ireland is still going to be a major factor, but you'll have places like, you know, Italy, Greece, Poland, you know, something like that. Not so much now. So the two main ones here are Ireland and Germany. Now, you're going to have some major factors. Well, why? Why these guys? What's going on with this one? Well, largely you've got starvation as a major factor. You'll have an Irish potato famine, and you'll also have famines going on, especially in places like southern Germany, that, you know, these people are making decisions like, well, we could go someplace else, but it might be awful. But if we stay here, we know for sure we're going to die. So they get out of these places. You're also going to see that beyond straight-up economic opportunity reasons, there are a number of failures of democratic revolutions in Europe, especially in 1848, that are going to lead a lot of people to, you know, hey, I can stay here and continue to agitate towards, you know, we need democracy and we need a constitution and we need a representative republic, or I could just leave and go to America and be in a place where they already have that. And so you're going to see a lot of people are going to avoid political persecution and come to America for those kind of reasons. All right. Now, some sizable numbers of these guys are going to move to farmlands, especially some of the ones from Germany that are going to have sizable families that are going to bring along with them. For example, Minnesota begins to fill up with German people. If you ever have been there, you know, there's a reason that Minnesota has the Vikings as their pro football team. Minnesota and Wisconsin are going to have a lot of German immigrants that are going to kind of go into these areas. But a lot of these, both Irish and German, they're going to settle in these cities. They're going to come over sort of singly, and eventually families are going to come over as they make enough money. And so they got to find work. Well, what kind of work are they going to be able to find? And that's in these unskilled labor industries that are beginning to spring up in a lot of the urban spaces. So here you can see a couple of immigrants. The Irish guy is going to come over. He's about to cross the sea and try his luck in America. And this German immigrant, all he's got to his name is the valise that holds his possessions. And he's getting his photograph taken as he heads here into America. This is a German family as they're making their home here in Missouri around St. Louis in the early 1800s. And this is really cool. Not only is this guy able to crank out apparently all these children or numerous relations, but the dude actually is so awesome. One beard isn't enough. He actually has to have two. So I wish we could kind of get away with that today. But that's what's going on with this. Now, when you look at the changes that are taking place in this urban space, okay, you've got some really massive, noticeable changes. If you were to go to 1790 America, all right, America is still a hugely rural country overall. The United States had two cities that could say they have 20,000 citizens or more, all right? By 1860, 43 U.S. cities had 20,000 citizens or more. So this is a major change. It takes place in 70 years. So generally speaking, over the span of a normal kind of person's lifespan, you know, throughout this, if you were living in one of these urban spaces, you are going to be noticing a year-by-year, very visible change. When you think back and say, hey, the city looked like this when I was a kid. Now that I'm an adult, holy cow, big, big changes. Whenever you have major population explosions, you always get urban blight. It isn't the fact that you've got large numbers of people moving into the city that's a problem. It's okay. You can have that. It's when you have it over such a short period of time that it creates infrastructural difficulties of basically every single nature. And the reason for that is you have to build support structures for people to live in urban environments. They're not going to dig their own well, right? That doesn't happen in an urban environment. And so in order to do this, well, how do you get water? Well, you dig a line and you run it out with a pipe and then the building's got water and okay, fine. All that takes time. And if so many people are moving in over so short a period of time, forget about whether or not these poor immigrants can pay for it or not. Even if they can, which in many cases they can't, okay? Even if they can, there just isn't enough time in some cases to get all this work done. So sewage, what you're going to do with all the waste, crime, water, rats, garbage, and most of all these slum neighborhoods where these buildings are packed tightly together, you've got huge numbers of poor people, disease, all these kind of factors are coming together, and you've got these big, big problems that take place in the American cities before 1860. So these are the conditions that a lot of these immigrants find themselves kind of stuck in. But you're also going to see that these native-born Americans are going to be sort of tangentially stuck in it as well, because they're not lost on what is going on. They're born in America, and hey, the city is getting run down, and this is pretty awful. And so they don't have to look far to figure out, you know, sort of what is going on. And I really like this scene. This is an artist's rendition of New York, or what it looks like here in the 1840s. And you've got, you know, the buildings very close together. They're dirty. They're run down. The streets are, of course, you know, pretty bad. You've got garbage with this. You've got a huge number of people. You don't have good ventilation. And, of course, you've got a pig and a dog fighting over something in the street, which seems sort of odd. Yeah, for those of you who've been to New York, you know, you don't, I don't remember seeing any pigs. But, of course, how a lot of farmers got their pigs and other, you know, other animals to market was they just drove them through town. And, of course, some of them would get away, and some of them would sort of take up residence in the city. So you did have big problems. And, of course, the major source of locomotion for a lot of people carrying goods is going to be horses are going to be pulling these carts. Horses eat. Horses also poop. And it goes on the ground, and it sort of stays there. So major, major problems with this. And you're going to see a big movement of what we refer to as anti-foreignism, or what they refer to as nativism, all right? And sometimes we lose sight of what the word native means. A native just means you're born there, right? Now, for those of you who set up nativity scenes at Christmas, it's little baby Jesus, you know, that sits on the counter or whatever. It's because it's his birth, that kind of thing, all right? So When I talk throughout this section, when I talk about Native American, I'm not talking about American Indians like out on the frontier in feather headdresses and that kind of stuff. I mean Americans that were born in America as opposed to immigrants that are living in America. Okay, so many of these Native Americans, they look down their noses at these immigrants. And basically, if you want to get a sensibility of what in history debates about immigration were like, all you have to do is look at what debates about immigration are like now. You just replace one immigrant group, say Mexicans or people from India or Korea or whatever, you know, whichever immigrant group that you want to talk about, and you just replace it with the immigrant groups of that period, Irish, German. And you'll have the arguments are exactly the same. Okay? For example, these guys are looking down their noses that have problems with it. They don't see people who are willing to sort of come over and they want to work hard and they want to get ahead and you know they want to get out of the hellhole country that they had come from. On the negative side, they see these people that are poor, they don't speak English, they have different cultures. Many of them were Catholic. This was a majority Protestant nation that was still pretty fearful of Catholic Christianity. And as a result of that, a lot of these guys drank like fish. You had a strong strain of growing anti-sort of alcohol movements that were going on in the United States. And of course, a lot of these guys come in and they're from Ireland and Germany. And they drink a lot. For those of you who are Irish or German out there, you know what I'm talking about, right? So anyway, so you're going to see some of these Americans, they want to take political action to try to stem this tide. They would form a sort of political party known as the Know Nothing Party. And the reason that they call themselves that is they would not, they're very secretive in that if they didn't know that you were in the group, and you say, hey, aren't you in that anti-foreign political movement? And you say, oh, I know nothing about it. So, but if they recognized you, then they would talk to you about it. And the way that they would sort of send the signal is they would stick a matchstick up out of their sort of breast pocket of their jacket, and that was sort of the secret code that let you know that they were in on the Know Nothing Party. And the number one manufacturer of matches in the country at that point was the Loco Foco Match Company. And so another nickname for these guys, they were the Loco Foco Party. So anyway, that's just a little aside. But basically, these guys get together, and they're going to create political action to combat immigration. They want to keep these guys out. They want to keep them under control if they get in. They want to do something about these guys. In some cases, it got violent. You had riots that would break out in these cities between native groups and immigrant groups. If you ever see the film Gangs of New York, you can get a really good sensibility of what's going on here in pre-Civil War and then even all the way up to 1863 America with some of the violence that's taking place between native-born Americans and immigrant Americans. The film's pretty good. It's about 30 minutes too long. It really didn't need the love story. So anyway, at any case, immigrants are facing a lot of discrimination from this. Like I mentioned, also a lot of violence. But they continued coming and coming. And they learned to get along in the United States by sort of banding together. And that's exactly what you'd have. You got a little bit of a political cartoon here of the Loco Foco Express. They're going to be sending candidates, hopefully to Washington and also to the governor's mansion. In Albany, this is from the state of New York, so it gives you a little bit of sensibility of what these guys are kind of up to here in pre-Civil War America. And I got a couple of political cartoons to give you an idea of how a lot of native-born Americans view these immigrants. In this case, you got an Irish immigrant, probably, and you'll notice that the artist has taken this guy and sort of given him animalistic features. He looks a bit like a monkey. He's got the crown is of the mob. He's got the Pope's kind of hat on because he's a papist, he's a Catholic, and he's armed. He's got a stick, he's got a knife, he's got a pistol, he's sitting on a barrel of rum. All of his Confederates around him, they're all monkey-like, dirty, nasty people, and they're going to beat the crap out of good, sensible, native-born Americans. So this is one of the views of this. And here's another little view of this, a typical kind of Irish immigrant. And you can see in the background, you got your average Joe sort of American. He's talking to Uncle Sam, what are we going to do about this situation? Because we've got our immigrant guy here, and he's fat from eating all of the Americans' good stuff. He's in us the pork and the flour, and all the good stuff's been consumed by this guy. He's been taking it all up because he's taking power with the stick and with the knife. He's a sort of a gang kind of guy. And, of course, Uncle Sam, he's looking, I don't know, the guy's hands and talking, I don't really know what to do about this. I don't know. And so, of course, average Joe American, he says, I know what to do about this, and he's rolling his sleeves. Probably not because he's going to go do the dishes. So we're going to see that violence is going to break out in a lot of these situations. Economically affecting all of this is the changes here, especially towards mechanization, which is the use of machinery to do a lot of the tasks that normally had been done by people with their hands. And this is something the United States is moving more and more towards. Following the example of the British, but you're also going to see a lot of other countries around the world are moving towards mechanization as well. And that's machine manufacture rather than artisan manufacture. What you typically had before was somebody really, really good at making something, and it took them a number of years to be able to get good at doing it. And now all of a sudden you got a machine that can just sort of, you know, crank these out as quick as you can work it. Factories throughout this period not only begin producing products, but also producing equipment, machines making machines. So we sort of have a sort of Terminator kind of moment here, beginning in America, and relying ever increasingly on the idea of interchangeable parts. For those of you who have ever had your car sort of break down and need a new alternator, you just go down to like the auto parts store, and you tell them what kind of car you have, and then they give you an alternator, and it's going to work, because it works. That type of alternator works in all cars of your type, right? And you put it in, and as long as you put it in, right, it'll work. That's the idea of an interchangeable part. It's relatively cheap. You don't have to send it back to the guy who made the car, who's got to then figure out, okay, I need a new alternator, I got to figure out how to do it. That would be time consuming, it would be very expensive. And so the idea of interchangeable parts is one that radically speeds up manufacture all around. Well, these factories now can crank out a huge amount of product. But the problem is, if you make more product than you have customers, you're really not doing yourself any favors, all right? And so how do you expand your customer base? One of the problems, of course, you've got to surmount is geography. Because especially if you sell a product very large, very heavy, like, you know, iron girders or something like that, how do you get it out to people in cities that are going to need this? And so, yeah, how do you get a product out, even if it's, you know, clothes or furniture or something like that? How do you get that out to people not immediately within, you know, sort of walking distance of your store? Well, you have also, at this point, a growing network of improved internal communications. And we'll talk about those now, how they get their customer base is much, much larger and much better served. So this gives you an idea of kind of the factory nature of pre-Civil War America. You have rows and rows and rows of machines. Many of them are being operated. In some cases, a lot of these textile companies that make cloth, make clothing, were staffed by women. You also notice a lot of child labor, a lot of kids. You know, well, you could go to school and learn to read and write, or you could help us pay the bills, Billy. And so you can see one of these operations going on here in North Carolina where they're employing men and women and children in their operations as well. Major social, political, economic change is going to come from one of these guys with a receding hairline, and that's Eli Whitney. Okay. Now, for those of you who've sort of been paying attention and not just sort of having the video show kind of run in the background while you play Angry Birds on your phone or whatever, the economy of the South, a lot of you are like, he's been talking a lot about like tobacco and rice and indigo, and I thought it was like cotton. I'm pretty sure, you know, I was paying attention that it was like cotton was like a big deal in the South. And he hasn't mentioned it yet. The reason for that is because until really the very late 1700s, and for the most part the early 1800s, cotton really wasn't much of a thing in the Southern economy. Cotton does grow very easily in the South, but to turn it into something useful, you can't just sort of, you know, take a big ball of cotton right off the plant and stick it in your sewing machine and make yourself something useful, all right? It took a lot of expensive hand labor to de-seed and to clean. Literally, what they would do is they'd usually get a slave, and they would, you know, she'd get a big bushel basket of this kind of stuff, and she'd use her fingers, and she'd work the seeds out, and she'd drop it in there. It took a long time, okay? And so cotton cloth was therefore very expensive, all right? Eli Whitney, in 1793, he's on loan. He's serving as a tutor for a wealthy family on their little plantation in the Carolinas. And he sees this shirt that's made of cotton. And for those of you who are watching this not naked right now, you're wearing cotton probably, all right? So those of you at your house and you decided you didn't want to get a shower and come to class today, or for whatever reason you're watching this, you could be sitting around, you know, just in your birthday suit or whatever, but for most of us that do like to walk around with clothes on, we're wearing cotton. And the reason for that is cotton is awesome, okay? It's lightweight, it's cool, it breathes, it is the stuff of the gods, okay? And if you don't believe me, go put on a pair of wool underwear, and then you'll totally agree with me, which is what these guys had to deal with until cotton came around. And so Whitney is like, cotton, this is the bomb, right? And why don't we all have this kind of stuff? And they say, well, we've got some cotton that we do here, but for the most part, only wealthy people could afford cotton. And so, well, why not? So, well, we got to pay, you know, resources to this woman, and she's got to sit there, and it takes forever. And so it's really, really expensive. So only wealthy people can afford it. So we don't grow a lot of it because we don't have much of a market for it. Only the rich can get it. Well, Whitney, being the bright young guy that he is, he says, I think I can invent a machine that'll do all that work. And he invents this hand crank cotton engine, or something that we have shortened to cotton gin. For those of you who thought that there was liquor involved, sorry, right? It's not like you drink gin and then make cotton. Anyway, it's about this big, the initial sort of prototype for it. And you just dump the cotton into the top, you turn the hand crank, and the little teeth and the wheels, they push it through there. The seeds shoot out the bottom. The cotton is cleaned and pops out the side. And to give you an idea of how much more efficient this was, it was 50 times more effective than hand cleaning. So for every, you know, bushel of cotton a person could do per day by hand, you can make 50 of them with the machine. Cotton prices go through the floor. This also means now that anybody can buy it, which means you can make tons of it, and you can make a lot of money. So the business booms as a result of that. One of the when you look at all the changes that take place as a result of that, now slavery was starting to kind of go out, 1780, 1790s. A lot of people, even in the Deep South, were looking, yeah, it's not really as profitable as it used to be. Liberty, justice, equality, I really think, I don't know if we should even own slaves. So there are a whole host of reasons why slavery was starting to decline. You see a manumission movement in the United States. So people were letting their slaves go. Then all of a sudden, cotton comes in. Plantations that use slave labor now are more necessary than ever if you want to make gobs and gobs of money. And so slavery that was starting to die out in the north and then also the northern parts of the south, huge numbers of slaves are now moving to the deep south to take advantage of the fact that, you know, masters are buying them and they are being forced to work on these plantations. You see chain gangs of people moving from like Tennessee down to Alabama. The Mississippi River becomes a massive conduit of slaves being sold on the New Orleans market. Radical changes. The slavery trajectory was starting to go down and then all of a sudden cotton comes in and bam, it shoots through the roof. So slavery is going to go from being waning to expanding massively in order to meet the labor demands for planting and picking of cotton. So there's the guy, right? Like I said, losing his hair, sort of like me, right? And he makes one of the major, major social changes in history. And this is it, right? This is the museum piece, right? There it is, the cotton gin. And modern cotton gins you go to today, they're huge, you know, size bigger than this room, you know, these giant machines, you dump in these tons and tons of cotton. And while they're a lot bigger and they run on electricity and all that kind of stuff, they basically work the same way, though, as the one that Eli Whitney did. You know, you got the little cranks, you got the little saws, you got the little pokey things, and the seed comes out the bottom, and then the clean cotton comes up the other side. So they work basically the same today as they did. But again, one of the connections, whether it's cotton or whether it's iron or whether it's, you know, whatever it is you're making, is how do you reach your market? And of course, how does your market reach you? The government begins to pay for highways in order to prove overland travel. If you were traveling on the nation's sort of road system, and I hesitate to even call it a road system, in the 1700s, it was pretty bumpy, it was not very reliable. Huge parts of most roads, especially as you get further and further out of town, are, you know, washed out, covered, you know, grown up with roots. I mean, it was, overland travel was really unreliable. Okay, it was not fast, it was not good, especially not for transporting large amounts of goods. So how do we begin to fix this, all right? And that is the idea that states and the federal government begin to pay for improving the road system. Now, the first major effort of this is going to be the National Road. This is going to link the East and the West through the Cumberland Gap. And it's basically in line with what we were talking about last time with Henry Clay's system, right? That the East, it looks like the East and the West are kind of separating, they're kind of going their own way. So we've got to find a way to link them economically. It would go all the way through from the East through the Cumberland Gap, and it would link the Atlantic ports around Washington to St. Louis all the way on the Mississippi River, right? You're also going to see a number of other roads begin to branch out. For example, you'll see the old King's Highway that existed during the British period of US 1 will eventually begin to expand take over here in the eastern United States. This is going to do a pretty good job of improving land communication, but it's also going to help to spur trade and connectivity between these regions. And so here's a map, gives you an idea of the National Highway, where it looks like today. Basically, if you go on US 40 or Interstate 70, it's mostly the same route that it takes today. And so this gives you an idea of kind of where it's going through. It starts here in Baltimore, goes through Washington, heads all the way through the Cumberland Gap here, and then eventually Ohio, Indiana, Illinois, all terminating all the way out there in St. Louis. Go forward. There we go. It took a lot of work in order to be able to do this. Here you can see some construction crews leveling and grading the road under the care of sort of surveyors and supervisors. And this is what you would have seen all along it, being used in part by pioneers and being used by traders, people heading west, people heading east. This is what it looks like. This is Interstate 70 and US 40, what it looks like today. Give you an idea of kind of the fact that it's still there, more or less in use and in operation. Interesting little side note, for those of you who go around and you see a lot of the roads, not so much the interstate system, but a lot of the old roads, they're old roads that just got paved over. So, sometimes taking a little trip down some of these roads, you're actually sort of taking a little bit of a trip through history as well. Some of them are really, really old. US 90, for example, that runs right here in front of the college, the stretch that's in between us and Tallahassee, the Tamuqua and the Apalachee Indians used this. And so the road's, a few thousand years old? It's just paved over. So straightened, banked up, but it's basically the same old Indian trail that these guys, that their feet stomped down over the past few hundred years. While roads are really important, it's still not necessarily the best way to carry products, especially large amounts of products or very heavy loads of products. And that is because, in some cases, it doesn't, you got 100 tons of like steel girders. There aren't enough horses anywhere to carry that. They're all going to die. There's no efficient way to carry that over land. Only the buoyancy of water is a good way to transport, in some cases, very, very heavy loads. Well, that works great if you're going to be using a large river or if you've got the ocean at your beck and call. But in many cases, if you've got territories you want to connect by water and you don't have either one of those natural formations, how do you overcome that? Well, the canal is the way that you do that, all right? If you've ever seen a ditch, and for those of you that drive around this area, you've seen ditches, and you've seen what happens to the ditches when it rains a lot, and that is they fill up with water. Basically, a canal is a great big ditch. It's a man-made river. They dig a shallow trench, they fill it up with water, and then you can put a boat on it, and you can load it down with a whole lot of stuff, and it's the buoyancy of the water that holds up the load rather than an animal or your back or whatever it is you're trying to carry it with. All you have to do is provide enough force to get it to go forward. And that's exactly what is going to happen here. A lot of times oxen or horses, in some cases mules, are going to be used. They'll be on the bank and they'll have a tether and they'll just pull these things forward, use a rudder to keep it out in the middle of the canal. And what this does is it creates water traffic to places that basically had originally had no access to the ocean. So now you've got the ability to get your goods from an inland area, say upstate New York, Ohio, some of the other places, and then if you go out to the Atlantic Ocean or if you go to the Great Lakes, now you have the ability to get to the rest of the world. All right? You're also going to see water traffic thoroughfares, like when you're traveling on the interstate and then all of a sudden, there's a McDonald's, there's a Motel 6, there's a gas station, there's all this commerce that takes place. That's because you're on a route of thoroughfare, and where they intersect is where commerce is going to take place. The most important canal, kind of the pet project canal that really gets started with all this, is the Erie Canal. This is going to connect the Hudson River in central New York to the Great Lakes around Buffalo in upstate New York. But you're going to see a lot of other canals are going to link the Midwest to the Great Lakes, as well as a few that link the inland areas to the Atlantic directly. And these are going to be some major, major changes. Not as big of a deal with us today. Our transportation sort of styles have kind of changed. First, railroads eventually would take over from canals as sort of major internal forms of communication, and of course the automobile, and then of course a lot of our international communication now is still on ship or via flight. These aren't really quite options yet for automotive and air travel. Aren't going to be there in the 1800s. But trade is going to boom as heavier and heavier loads can reach more and more places, and some of these places are going to be entrepôt for economic activity. And so you can see this is a town situated on one of these canals. You can see some of these really, really big barges, carrying loads of these people. You had an overpass of a road that this guy is herding his group of pigs to market or to, I don't know, wherever you take pigs. But you can see a lot of economic activities taking place as a result of the canal being there. And now all of a sudden this farmland isn't just, the local farmers can buy or the local people can buy my farm product. No, I can put it on one of these boats and I can take it somewhere. And here you can see the horses pulling the barge this way. Some of these places, though, had to go through some pretty remote areas. As you can see, this is a horse pulling one of these canal barges in kind of the middle of nowhere on the Erie Canal in upstate New York. But it creates long-distance, reliable transportation. You couple that now with steam power, and you're going to have a radical change. All right? Steam, for a long, long time, had been something that people had kind of looked at and said, okay, if we sort of harness that power of forcing steam through a pipe to be able to turn a crank, we could do amazing things with it. And you'll see actually some of the earliest uses of that is going to be to turn the cranks of machinery, especially in Europe and eventually here in the United States. But what if we were to take that and put that in a boat? Here's an interesting idea. In 1807, Robert Fulton, the entrepreneur, he's going to send a ship with a steam engine powering it up the Hudson River. And it's a bit of a publicity stunt. And his business doesn't totally last with this. But it's going to start the steamship craze in America. This seems like not a big deal. For those of you who have ever been sort of boating, you've been fishing or whatever in your life, and yeah, okay, whatever. You know, you turn the motor on and you go. No. Okay? Prior to this, you went where the wind and the water let you go. You didn't go up a river unless the wind was blowing just right. You didn't just decide one morning, yeah, you know, let's go up river. No, because the force of the water is going to push you back down unless you get enough force of the wind going in the opposite direction to help you go up the river. Of course, you're only going to go up the river very, very slowly. Now, with steam power, you can go up river, down river, cross river, whatever, at whatever speed you can sort of muster from the engine. So this idea that you can move completely in abeyance of wind, tide, and flows of rivers and waters is going to totally change the economic modes of travel. Very, very attractive to people because it could speed things up immensely. It turns rivers now, instead of into sort of where you float down to, you know, transact business, it's two-way water highways. Goods become cheaper all along the major waterways. This is especially true of the Mississippi. The Mississippi River becomes kind of the major highway of America. If you read, you know, any of, you know, Mark Twain stuff, of Tom Sawyer, Huckleberry Finn, the Mississippi has this sort of mystique. It often becomes kind of the center of their sort of social focus, because very much economically, at least, it was. Here you can see the side wheel paddle steamer that is representative of kind of Fulton's design. Where the engine is kind of in the middle and the paddles are on the side of the ship. Eventually it would give way to the rear wheel, much more efficient paddle steamer, as these would ply their trade up and down the Mississippi River. And this is the effect that you can see on places like St. Louis, where now dockyard facilities and economic activity can take off and mushroom thanks to their access to the rest of the world by the fact that the Mississippi River now is basically not just a one-way street anymore. It's a two-way street. You can go up and down, and you're going to have a lot of success with this as well. Now, the railroad, the iron horse, as it's sometimes referred to, becomes much more important to our story in American history, too, when we get to the late 1800s. It's going to be a radical game changer. But it does get its start here, and it does have an important role to play through the 1860s in the Civil War. Its beginning is going to be relatively small, like a lot of inventions. It's going to start off with kind of one prototype in 1828. The first demonstration of this is going to be the rocket, and it was called that because of the insane speeds at which the rocket could travel, which was 20 miles an hour. Most of you, if you're sort of scooting along at 20 miles an hour in your car, you think there's maybe something wrong with your car. But again, the secret behind the railroad is steam power as well, because instead of a boat on the water, you've got one more or less on land. Railroads are going to expand from the northeast. The northeast is going to be where these tracks and engines are going to be in their heaviest concentration, because this is where, for the most part, the manufacturing firms are. They have not only the ability to create the railroad, but they also have the need to use the railroad to sort of get around and transport their product via rail. But they would eventually spread out because they are a very useful overland form of communication. They would head to the south and to the west. By 1860, the United States had 30,000 miles of track in the United States. Three-quarters of it, though, was in the north. This is going to be especially problematical for the Confederacy in the Civil War, because they only have a quarter of the railroad track in America. But why is a railroad attractive? Right? It can make long runs in fairly short time, and it was reliable in basically all weather. You know, you go to the airport today and say, oh, the horrendously bad thunderstorm, we can't take off. Generally speaking, the railroad doesn't, well, it's raining too much, we can't go. I mean, maybe if there's like an avalanche across the tracks or something. But for the most part, you can go all the time, and you can keep to a very, very tight schedule. You can take heavy loads of freight, and so it's a pretty reliable and will become an even more reliable technology. So here you get an idea of kind of what typically in the early 1800s, what a lot of these steam engines would look like. Here's a demonstration of the rocket. I know a lot of you are like, that looks like one of those industrial-sized grills that you get from like your church picnic or something like that. And it basically sort of is, but instead of cooking chicken, it uses the power to turn the wheels and moves at the insane speeds of 20 miles an hour. This map really gives you a good idea of kind of how the dark black lines are the main lines, and then the lighter lines are the sort of the ancillary lines that this will branch out from that. But this gives you a good idea of where the track in America is. You'll notice that in the Northeast, man, it's pretty thick, it's pretty heavy, and then it kind of goes out, and then it really starts to get kind of thin and kind of sparse as you head down into the South and then the West. And in fact, during the Civil War, Florida only had one line of track, and it wasn't even connected to anything else. It just went from sort of the northern part to Jacksonville, and it just kind of connected that area there. So it would have to be after the Civil War that a lot of these places get connected to the rest of the network, right? You put all this together, and you're going to have the market revolution, all right? And that, of which we refer to, all right? So you've got increased interconnectivity of these people. They got access to each other either by road, rail, or ship, steam power, something like that. And you're also going to have the beginnings of industrialization, mechanization, massive amounts of product. More and more people are going to be able to afford it, whether it's cotton, whether it's iron, you know, whatever it is they're making, interchangeable parts with factories, right? You've got really some important booms that are going on in America in terms of population, in terms of labor. Really, everything is beginning to explode economically on a massive, massive scale, right? When you look at the three main areas of the United States, you've got the North, the South, and the West, right? So when you look at what is making all of them tick, you've got to answer certain questions, all right? So in the North, you've got industry that is really beginning to take off. You've got the factory culture, you've got urbanization, and so you've got to answer one of the questions is, well, what kind of labor are we going to have? Because the labor has to be cheap enough to make the product affordable. While nobody begrudges anybody else for making a lot of money, you get a job and, hey, I got a lot of money. Well, good for you, but if it costs too much to make a product and nobody can afford it, then the product is not going to get made, at least not for very long. So immigration is going to supply that. These people are willing to come in, work for very little money, in large enough numbers, and so you're going to allow industry to take off. So you're going to have a manufacturing boom as a result of that. But then, well, how do we get these products to a large enough market? Well, the trade links, transportation of products out from these urban areas, and then the foodstuffs into the urban areas, is going to create the necessary environment to create the boom that takes place here in these northern cities. When you look at the South, you have industry that is going to rear its head in terms of the cotton gin, railroad, transportation, that allows their product, ever increasingly, cotton, to take off. Their connectivity is going to come especially from rivers and steam power, somewhat through the railroads. And their labor solution is going to be black slavery. The system that had started to taper off, is going to pick way, way back up. And it's going to create what we often refer to as a cottonocracy, where cotton reigned as king, that everything sort of revolved around that, the social situation in terms of wealthy whites, poor whites, and black slaves begin to revolve around this. The political system begins to reflect that, where the wealthy white ownership class begins to rise to the top. All of this is going to be one of the results, and there's going to be more on that later in the semester. In the West, you have continued expansion. Thanks to the growing trade networks that now enable these people to sell their farm products, really in some cases on a worldwide scale. The labor solution, of course, is largely going to be solved by these people having insanely large families. And the Ohio River Valley, for example, becomes America's breadbasket, all right? I've often still heard this referred to by ecology people that there's enough fertility in the Ohio River Valley to feed the world a couple of times over, something like that. So this period here is where these guys are going to be expanding westward. They're going to be farming. They're going to be creating the foodstuffs necessary to sort of fuel all of this activity nationally. You get an idea of what's going on here. You get these northern factories. You get the quays of the railroads, huge numbers of these immigrant workers. Out in the West, you've got some mechanization. You've got a McCormick reaping machine of these family farms is what's going on. And in the South, you've got steam power, and you've got the power of the cotton gin with the cotton plantation and the slaves that are working this land. So as this is going forward, we're seeing major economic expansion, radical changes in terms of American society. And so when we look at the trajectory of the specific events that take us through this period and then a little bit beyond this period towards the American Civil War, This is sort of why this happens. This is what's going on in the background with men and women and children and immigrants and black slaves and free people and what's going on here in America to explain all that. So that is the end of this section.